me.
Oh, okay.
Pass
yeah.
down to Jaffy.
All right.
Okay. Are you guys ready?
I think so.
Go on
yeah, everybody's up.
Okay.
So, good afternoon. I'm Nilesh Kavia. I'm the VP of Finance and Corporate Services for the region. Thanks for joining us today. First, I'd like to start with thanking our RUH facilities and maintenance staff for all the hard work that they've been doing over the past few days to get us through this difficult situation. Many of them worked through the night and worked very hard to get some of the issues that we have resolved. As well, I want to thank our patients, employees, and care providers for their patience and cooperation over the last few days. The situation today is a little brighter than it was yesterday. Our crews have managed to restore our interim power, suction, medical air, and critical ventilation and heating equipment, as well as our parkade elevator. However, in the event of another power outage or failure, we currently don't have backup power for some of those key systems, but we do have mitigation plans in place to hold us over, and then in the long term, we'll be looking at some long-term strategies to get us sustainable. The work that we were doing through the week was a strategy that we've been working on to get us to a more sustainable place with relation to our electrical infrastructure overall at RUH. The steam services have been restored, which steam is used at the hospital both for heating as well as for sterilization. And aside from ongoing maintenance work, our main focus today is the rescheduling of patients that we unfortunately had to postpone. And my colleague Jackie Mann will speak to that.
Hi, I'm Jackie Mann, Vice President for Integrated Health Services.
Can I have you just move over?
Yeah, you bet.
Yeah.
You guys are set?
Yeah.
Go on ahead.
All right. So as you know, there were a total of 37 surgeries postponed over the last 2 days. And I do want to express my sincere apology that we had to cancel these surgeries. Absolutely recognize that for every patient and their family, it's a very stressful time to have surgery. We really had to do this in order to ensure their safety. So we continue to work very collaboratively with surgeons' offices to ensure that we can get those surgeries rescheduled. We've begun that process just over the last hour. So we're ready to move ahead tomorrow with our regular surgeries, and we're currently today working very hard to reschedule those people who've been postponed. We encourage patients to contact their surgeons directly, and we'll be able to work with them to ensure that they get rescheduled. However, if they're struggling and having any problems and need questions answered, they absolutely should contact our client representative office. So we'll take questions from you now.
How long will it take to reschedule that many surgeries?
You know, I'm not sure. We're in the process right now, and I know that we're already able to reschedule a few over the next couple of days. It requires us to work with the surgeons, look at what's scheduled out into the future, and really determine how we can get these people in. So our goal is really over the next 24 hours, get a plan in place so that people know what the plan is.
Will this affect surgical wait times, the goal that you guys had, I think, for fall?
Yeah, you know, certainly it will affect surgical wait times in that each of these patients are going to wait a little bit longer. I think more importantly is the impact on the patient and the family. So my bigger concern right now is that these patients and families are waiting to have their surgery. They were expecting to have it over the last couple of days, and we need to get them rescheduled so that they know what the plan is.
When you say a little bit, like how far out are we talking about? Are we talking weeks, months? What are we talking about?
I think it will be over the next week or a little bit more. So we've scheduled a few patients into the next 2 days, and we're looking at next week. So, you know, our goal is obviously to get this done as quickly as possible. There's a number of things that go into this, right from the availability of the patient to the entire team. Some of these surgeries require more than one surgeon. So we just have to really look at how can we move things around to make sure that we can get these people in.
And so just so I'm clear, oh, and if you could just sort of look at that.
Oh, sorry, you just dropped
me. I know.
Over there.
So just so I'm clear, where are you guys at as far as tomorrow? Like, are you going to start surgeries back up tomorrow? Or
right. So tomorrow, we're going ahead with our surgeries as we're scheduled. So early this week, those surgeries for tomorrow would have already been scheduled. We're going to go ahead with those. In addition to that, we're looking at what other cases we will be able to do that were postponed over the last 2 days.
What type of disruption has this caused to some of these patients? Are you going to be sort of compensating for maybe travel or hotel stays if you scheduled them for later on this week?
So I think the disruption to families more than anything is the plans that they have made. So that's why we're trying so hard to expedite things. I think our normal process is that we work with individual families and really try to help them to get the arrangements made that need to be made.
In terms of, ER services, are those beginning again this afternoon or is that tomorrow?
Yeah, emergency services are continuing. They are up and running.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
I guess kind of how far is the reach for how many people this affects? You know, depending on the surgery, you maybe have stay after, you have all nurses and doctors and stuff. Can you give us an idea of how far it can actually reach up within the hospital?
Sure. So 37 patients, some of those patients would have been coming in and going home the same day. A number of them would have required an inpatient stay in our hospitals. So, you know, they would have made arrangements to have that inpatient stay. So certainly the biggest impact is upon them and their family. Absolutely.
What type of surgeries are we talking about? I know they were considered non-critical.
So there were, as we mentioned, all of the surgeries over the last 2 days were canceled. And so there's a wide variety. Obviously, there are surgeries that we only perform at the University Hospital here that are not performed at the other sites. So those would include surgeries such as heart surgery and brain surgery. So those kinds of surgeries only happen here. And some of the cases were certainly those. There was a variety of other procedures as well.
And you said you had two ORs open for emergency situations. Did those get used?
Actually, just checked before I came in, and I think we've done one emergency surgery actually over the last 2 days.
Are surgeons going to be required to do overtime as a result of this?
You know, at this point in time, we're just working with the surgeons and with the OR teams to make rearrangements. As far as expanding our hours, that's something that we will absolutely consider. We just really need to work with people on the ground this afternoon and try to make the best plans that we can.
Are you guys able to put a dollar amount to this at all with surgeons or even just the amount of overtime that you had people putting in for the panels to fix the and reroute?
Yeah, you know, I have to be totally honest with you. We've had our feet on the ground 24 hours a day over the last 2 days trying to work this through, so we've not taken time to do any cost estimates.
I have one more for Nilesh, if anyone else.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, yes. Wouldn't mind getting him too.
Yeah.
I was hoping you could explain how the backup power system works. Is there a backup generator, and if so, is it online? How does that work?
So I'll try to explain it in a way that's simple enough, and it has to be simple enough because I'm not an electrical engineer. So we do have a backup generator system that supplies our key critical systems that require power. We have two panels that distribute the power. So one of the panels has both normal power and backup power to it. The other panel only has normal power to it. In normal situations, the systems that are on normal power are ones that we don't consider critical and could go down for an hour or two without a massive interruption to services. The systems that are on the panel that has the backup are typically ones that we talked about earlier, such as the medical gas, the medical air, and our air circulation, as well as our fire pumps and those types of things. So currently what the situation is that the panel that failed, it was the one that had both the normal and the backup power. And in the short term, we don't have backup power for those key systems that we moved from the panel that failed to the panel that has normal power. Our plan in the short term is that for each of those we have a mitigation plan. If there was a power failure, we would have a mitigation plan for medical gas. We have gas tanks that are in place, and we have a supply that has now been extended to give us at least approximately 12 hours of redundancy. We also have redundancy plans for our suction, so we would have portable suctions and a logistical plan on how those would be deployed if needed. The only area that we have a risk on is our airflow, and we're working on what a short-term backup might be, and one of the things that we're going to take into consideration is putting in place a UPS. Our medium-term solution, obviously, is to replace the MPCC or the distribution panel that failed, and when we have that replaced, we'll be in a situation that we would have backup power as well as normal power for all of our critical systems.
So what did you learn from all of this? I mean, is there any sort of lessons that the health region's taking away from all this?
We're still working on the investigation of the root cause, so that'll give us a lot of learning. The situation of the failure that happened during a time that we were working on a more robust and sustainable condition for our electrical systems. So we, at this point, don't know if that failure would have happened in any case. So one of the learnings was that, we do have some very good emergency preparedness plans in place to respond to these types of situations. Healthcare generally is very good at responding to emergencies, and we have both an emergency preparedness plan as well as an incident command procedure that we put into place. Anytime we have a situation that creates a risk to our patients and families, and our learning really is that we've been able to pull on those resources and get through these circumstances when it is difficult. But the other learning too is that we have staff both on the clinical side as well as the support side that are very good at following these procedures and helping us through critical situations.
Given the aging infrastructure, are you worried that some sort of problem like this may pop up again in the future, just with some sort of infrastructure failing again?
Absolutely. Our infrastructure is a key concern for us. The project that we were working through is one of a multi-step process for us to resolve the infrastructure issues, particularly related to electricity. And we want to get to a stage where we have a comprehensive failure-safe situation at RUH. That's going to take a while, and it's a multi-stage, multi-step process to get there, and this was one of the initial steps on helping us to get to that sustainable state.
So you have no backup power, but you have plans in place just in case something goes down in an OR, is that correct?
We have backup power, we just don't have backup power for some of the key systems, and so for each of those we have a mitigation plan in place. And in the medium term, we'll be looking at restoring that panel, which will then have backup power.
How do you reassure patients then that they're safe?
The safety protocols that we have in place, we have a mitigation plan for each of the systems that could fail, and what we would do in that failure mode. We have a work plan on what the logistics would need to be in place. And the example of what actually did happen two nights ago demonstrates that we've got the ability to respond and have some mitigation plans in place when things do fail.
So you've been working for 48 hours here pretty straight, dealing with aging infrastructure, and you have a brand new hospital being built kind of beside you. How does that kind of feel when you're looking out the window?
Not sure what you mean.
Like, how does it feel tackling with this issue of aging infrastructure when there's...
Well, aging infrastructure, as I said, is something that we have to tackle all the time, and certainly is a concern for us. The building of a brand new hospital, which will have a better, newer electrical supply, it will be reassuring. By the time that hospital is built, we also hope to have much further along the path of sustainability on this existing facility as well.
All right.
Okay, thank you.